beers. I cannot wait for this. It's going to be a great fight. Kevin O'Connor from The Ringer, NBA analyst, one of the really smart guys who covers the NBA. Let's bring him on the show again. It's great to have him. We're so lucky in our business living in Los Angeles. We got all these NBA guys, and we just call them on the phone and say, get over here. Kevin, it's great to see you again. You wrote an article. We're all this morning waking up, and we're talking about the duos. And we're like, oh, poor Oklahoma City. They just got nothing but draft picks. You make the argument Oklahoma City may have won the offseason.
Yeah, I think with Oklahoma City calling, a number of NBA executives I talked to at the Summer League and since then, in regards to their offseason, they may have been the winners, getting 15. They have now 15 first-round draft picks over the next 7 years. So one of the executives I talked to mentioned that Kawhi Leonard recruiting Paul George away is what gave them an out in order to trade Russell Westbrook without any backlash.
Now, let's go to that, because I talked about this yesterday. I believe, here's my argument. In the NBA, we're really tough on coaches. If you have a big payroll and you don't win playoff series, you are on the hot seat.
Yeah.
Billy Donovan's the exception. He couldn't win games in the first round. Never rumored to be in trouble. Because I believe deep within the organization, they knew that Westbrook was great for the community, but wasn't the kind of player that could win them titles. But in a small market, you got to embrace the quarterback, Cam Newton. You got to embrace the star. So you believe it gave them a little bit of an out.
Sure. Yeah. I think with Russell Westbrook, there's a ceiling on what that team could become. Westbrook is an unbelievable player. He has proven that. He's gotten better over the years since his days at UCLA as a playmaker to become one of the league's best playmakers. However, with his shot selection, it has never evolved. With his activity off ball as a cutter, it has not evolved. And his defense still remains incredibly inconsistent. So with those flaws, I think there was a ceiling on what OKC could be. And they were locked into the cap with Steven Adams getting paid what he was, Robertson getting paid what he is. So for these guys, this was their out, and it turned out to be a gift, because had Kawhi Leonard not recruited Paul George, you're not getting as many first-round picks as you did. That's what gave OKC so much leverage. And then for Russell Westbrook, similar circumstances where Chris Paul and James Harden are going at each other, and Daryl Morey is upgrading from maybe, what, the 35th or 40th best player to a top 20 guy. That's the price it takes to pay. So for OKC, you know, it's disappointing for them that it ended this way. It's sad to see this run end for them, but ultimately they're better off with their just haul of draft picks, Shea Gildas-Alexander, and all the flexibility they'll have moving forward.
So Chris Paul is out there. I made the argument this morning that Miami's an NBA quicksand. They're the 17th best team in the league. For two reasons, Jamaica. Make the move. You're interesting in a very distracted NBA city. Aqua water, nice beach. Miami's like LA. Win or people tune you out. Butler and Chris Paul is not eHarmony, but it is interesting, and it's only 3 years. And the other thing is, you can get a bunch of draft picks for it. I think you have to make that move if you're Miami, which sounds counterintuitive to we've got to have Chris Paul. What do you make of Miami and OKC working? By the way, OKC has such a surplus of picks, Kevin, that you could give four away and sleep at night.
You know, I think in regards to Chris Paul, there's been conversation about how he's an untradeable contract. The reason why that is because so few teams need a point guard. So few teams would want an old point guard making nearly $40 million. That's what makes him untradeable. But I do think that sort of distorted perception of what Chris Paul is. When James Harden was off the floor the last 2 years, Chris Paul was still averaging around 21, 22 points with 12 assists per 36 minutes, if you extrapolate out his production per minute. So he's still a productive player when not standing off ball while James Harden's dribbling the ball. Makes sense why Houston would do that. But for Chris Paul, if OKC takes this into the season or Miami gets him now, I think we're going to start seeing the normal Chris Paul. Just an older version, a little bit worse, but still a really productive player. So for Miami, Colin, I think it makes sense to trade Chris Paul because you're not only getting something back now, maybe one pick, but you're also giving up some albatross contracts on your own end. So for Miami, it makes sense. But if you're taking this into the season and you have to give something up eventually, I think I'd hold off.
You know, we had Ben Simmons. I like Ben Simmons. And I've said this before. We're trying to make young people what they're not. I have these conversations with my son and my daughter. You are what you are. I'm not changing you. I'll add some occasional sprinkles of wisdom because I'm older, but your game is your game as a kid, and I'm going to let you develop. And we're trying to make Ben Simmons a shooter. We never thought Magic was a great shooter. He never became a great shooter. And by the way, Magic was an overrated defender. Magic gave us gifts for 6'9" we'd never seen. I'm overhearing about Ben can't shoot because he does so many other things well. Now, a lot of people think he was massively overpaid. How does it land for you?
He wasn't overpaid. No, I think Ben Simmons already, without a jump shot, is a great player. He's one of the more versatile defensive players in the entire league.
Yes, he is.
He is one of the best players in the open floor as a playmaker. He is somebody, when he wants to, can be a Blake Griffin, Draymond Green-style guy in the pick and roll, setting screens, rolling, picking apart defenses. The problem with Ben is that he mentioned to ESPN earlier this year that he does not see himself as that player. He wants to be more of the playmaking presence with the ball in his hands. But if he's willing to accept that role, being a screener, being a guy off ball, cutting and doing all the dirty work, he can be a great player for what he is and what he's been so far with Philadelphia. But in regards to the jump shot, it does matter, though. There comes a point where you need to at least be a mild threat off ball. And I think Ben Simmons shoots with the wrong hand. He shoots over 70% of his shots that aren't jumpers with his right hand. Floaters, layups, hook shots, layups, dunks. He is a right-handed player shooting with the wrong hand. Until he switches shooting hands, I don't see Ben Simmons becoming at least an average shooter.
That's the strangest. That is just crazy. We do have a lot of Americans, by the way, who write left-handed and do other things left-handed. I mean, that's common. But in the NBA, you score mostly with your right hand, and then you shoot jumpers with your left. That's a new problem in 2019.
It's the wildest thing. But he wouldn't be the only guy who's ever switched hands.
Who?
Tristan Thompson did. It didn't work out well for him, but he did. Nate Britt, college player, did as well. So he wouldn't be the first player, and he wouldn't be the only player who may shoot with the wrong hand. J.J. Redick said on his podcast a couple years ago that he thinks DeAndre Jordan, his ex-teammate from the Clippers, shoots with the wrong hand. DeAndre Jordan, another guy. Over 80% of his dunks are with his right hand, not his left hand, a guy who writes right-handed as well. So Ben Simmons isn't an isolated incident of a guy who just happens to be shooting with the wrong hand. And he admitted himself to the New York Daily News, I think in 2016, that he thinks he grew up shooting, that his dad made him shoot lefty just to give him a bit of variety with his right hand dominated game, shooting left jumpers with his left hand. Did not work out for him.
Dad's trying to be a good dad. Who knew?
Yeah, they don't work out.
Some of it's coincidental, some of it's not. When LeBron creates the shop with his business manager, and then KD creates the boardroom with his business manager, feels like a copy play, right? And I was just saying this morning, it's remarkable how often KD and LeBron's careers, Kobe did mimic Michael, sounded like him for years. So you start looking at the difference between KD and LeBron, the similarities, and they're similar. Some of them just crazy coincidences. Both basically lose to Kawhi Leonard and then leave their team. But LeBron has generally left teams that were aging, lacked cap space, or the vibe wasn't right. Kevin Durant left young, vibrant Oklahoma City and dominant Golden State. I do think Kevin is a wanderer, finding himself, and I do think sometimes, am I reaching saying, like even the press conference with, LeBron didn't hold a press conference with the Lakers. I'd never seen a star go to a team and not hold a presser. And then KD goes to Brooklyn and doesn't hold a presser. Do you ever sense there's a mimic thing going on with KD and LeBron?
For sure. But why wouldn't there be? I think it's a good playbook to follow for one of the best players of this generation in KD. What LeBron has done has laid really a blueprint out for other stars to follow with the way they control their own brand, they control their own destiny. And for KD, from a business standpoint, another guy who wants to become a team owner someday, makes some sense to adapt what LeBron did. But LeBron never had to go through an injury like KD did. I thought before last season, it made sense for KD to leave Golden State and go to New York to run his own team, to become the best player in the world, which he's always wanted to be, instead of second best. But after that injury, I still agree with the decision to go to Brooklyn with Kyrie. That's a great organization. However, I do wonder if at some point there'll be regret, whereas with Golden State, he had Draymond and Steph Curry and Klay Thompson to allow him to ease back, where there'll be more pressure immediately in Brooklyn.
How do you think he'll deal for a year not playing, rehabbing, and then going on social media and hearing about all these great tandems? LA's got a couple of tandems. Everybody's got a tandem now. How do you think that'll play KD for a year?
I mean, if it saddens me, I can't imagine how it makes him feel. I mean, it's disappointing, isn't it?
Right.
How great would it have been to also have KD and Kyrie as one of the great duos entering the season, where there are so many title contenders, teams that at least have a shot. And it's a shame that Brooklyn, it's unlikely KD would come back. And even if he did, he wouldn't be himself until maybe the following season, you hope.
You know, Joey and I said this yesterday. The one team, I watch all these odds. I am shocked at everybody bailing on Golden State. I still have Looney, Draymond, Clay by February, Steph. D'Angelo Russell's a real player. Steve Kerr, Bob Myers. Steph's made everybody work. Clay wouldn't work with everybody. KD wouldn't work. I am shocked. We do this with the Patriots. Tom's old. I'm bailing. It's the Chiefs. Smart wins. And when your star embraces new and others, I still think the Warriors can win the West.
They could, but what's Clay going to look like immediately after he returns in March, April, whenever it happens? I think for Golden State, there's certainly a chance. D'Angelo Russell is somebody who, in their system, it's going to be really interesting to see how he uses his off-ball ability, which he didn't get to show in Brooklyn, but is a really important skill for him since his days at Ohio State. But with that said, I still have a hard time putting Golden State with Clay out with a torn ACL now ahead of the two LA teams, and then even the other combinations in the West, Portland, Denver, right now, until we see Klay Thompson come back and be healthy, I have a hard time putting them ahead of them.
Do you like D'Angelo Russell as a player?
I do. I think Russell, ever since his rookie year without Kobe on the floor.
Now, talk about that.
The Kobe farewell tour ruined a lot of guys' careers that last season. And for D'Angelo Russell, look, it's the type of thing where with Kobe off the floor, he was able to run more pick and roll, able to handle the ball flow.
And his stats showed it.
And yeah, his per minute production was great. And as Lakers fans know, Russell was productive for them. He just didn't have the opportunity there. And him manifesting it eventually in Brooklyn is really not too much of a surprise. And now he'll get to evolve again in Golden State.
Yeah, and I don't think he's hit his prime. I think Russell's probably 2 years from prime.
He still needs to improve in certain areas. So like his career best season last year was driven so much by his productivity from mid-range on floaters and mid-range pull-ups. He still needs to improve in getting to the basket. He's one of the worst in the league at getting to the rim, drawing free throws, one of the worst all time of guys that are high volume shooters. So for him to become a more consistent player, especially on the playoff stage,
you need those free throws.
That's the next area.
Yeah. Kevin O'Connor, The Ringer. Great seeing you, man.
Thanks for having
you on the show. Joy with the news. Good stuff, Kevin. No.